engine bolts, lug nuts, even your oil cap has a specific torque spec from the factory. Sometimes you just got no time, or you got no patience, or you got no torque wrench, and you just want to take your old air gun and it down to snug as you can get it. But why is putting a nut on as tight as you can go a bad thing? Why do we even have torque specs in the first place? And what would happen if we tried to tighten a bolt with a 13-foot breaker bar? Fuck that. This is crazy, man. Well, in today's video, we are going to show you exactly what is happening inside a bolt as it gets over-torqued. We're also going to set up an experiment to see if we can replicate our research. So sit back and enjoy as we get down to the nuts and bolts of torque spec. Thanks to Omaze for sponsoring this week's episode of Bumper to Bumper. Now, if you guys don't know, we do a lot with Omaze because they offer you guys, the fans, chances to win dream cars and once-in-a-lifetime experiences, all while supporting amazing causes like the Ronald Reagan Medical Center at UCLA, the same place that saved our dear friend James Pumphrey's life. The cars that Omaze offers you the chance to win are sick. How would you like to win a custom Tesla Model X, or maybe even a Dodge Challenger Demon, or maybe even something like this? I know I would, and you could too, just like my buddy Sebastian, who won the Corvette Stingray we helped Omaze give away earlier this year. How's that Stingray, Sebastian? I hope you're having fun with it. So don't miss out on the chance to win your dream car and support a great cause at the same time. Head on over to omaze.com/cars and enter now for your chance to win. What are you guys waiting for? Now let's get back to some B2B. Don't worry, the car is not on fire. This is practical effects. Welcome to Donut, baby. Torque spec is the measurement of a force a given nut or bolt is designed to be used at. It's tight enough to hold the bolt in place, but not too tight so that it damages anything, including itself. And if we keep on turning that nut, however, a combination of things are gonna happen. The bolt will break, like we've seen. The metal clamped in between your nut and your bolt, that's gonna buckle, it's gonna squish. Or the bolt will permanently deform. Now, the strength of a bolt is known as tensile strength, and this is the amount of tension the bolt can withstand without being fractured. Now, if you multiply this by the surface area that tension is being applied to, you can get the tensile load that you're gonna apply to the bolt. So as bolts get more and more tension put on it, there comes a point called the yield point. And this is the amount of tension that it takes to permanently deform a bolt. Everything below this point is called the elastic range, and everything above this point is called the plastic range. Now, when you apply a load to a bolt in the elastic range and then take away that load, the material goes back to normal. The molecules that make up whatever material you're stretching, they snap back, like elastic pants. Just think of that, that'll make you remember that. But when you apply a force that gets into the plastic range and then take off the load once again, the material, it doesn't snap back. Those molecules are permanently broken and the material has undergone what's called plastic deformation. Now, torque spec is often 70 to 95% of this yield point depending on the application. So it's in that elastic range. After the yield point, the bolt hasn't necessarily failed though. In fact, you may have heard of TTY or torque to yield bolts. Beyond the yield point, the bolt can still be stretched a bit and hold up to higher tensile loads. But eventually, that tensile strength will plateau and then start to drop off. And that's the point where you break a bolt. Now imagine a spring. Now you can compress it just a little bit or you can pull it a little bit. But if you pull too far, it's going to permanently deform and it won't go back to its nice springy self, even though you didn't actually snap it. That's plastic deformation. Shout out to every 90s kid who broke a slinky that way. So to show you this, we've set up a few experiments outside. We're gonna use my F-150 as a test rig. How I got suckered into this, I don't know. But let's go to Outside Jerry and see what he's doing. Thanks, Inside Jerry. So we're gonna put some of this stuff to the test. We got a rig that we built up on the back of my F-150 here. We have an extender coming out of the hitch, and through that extender we have a bolt. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna start off by torquing that bolt to 40 foot-pounds and work our way up all the way to 150 foot-pounds. And my buddy here, Joey, He's gonna be measuring bolt length changes as we go up and over torque this bolt. And then we're gonna use this big old honker to see if we can actually get enough torque to snap an
1 inch thick
bolt. We also bought a 13 foot stainless pole to give us a little bit more leverage to see if we can use math to make it happen. And if not, we'll just use these guns.
We're gonna use the math. So what I'm doing now is I'm measuring our bolt to see how long it is before we put it under tension, so that when it stretches, when we do torque it to spec, we can see how much it's stretched by.
Now we tested several different types of bolts at varying degrees of torque, and what we found was that our 3.5 inch bolts would stretch about 0.5 millimeter at 120 pound feet of torque. Now when we undid those bolts, they sprung back to their original length. Now this is a bolt that is torqued down properly. It's got enough stretch that the elastic tension clamps the assembly together, but it still remains true to its original shape when the bolt tension is loosened. Now we tried this experiment again with thinner bolts to see if we could really show the bolt stretching, but you know, these freaking guns of mine showed up to do some damage and well, we broke it.
There you go, just both.
Yeah.
That's called snapping off the bolt, baby.
He's a punk. I've been working out.
So we were able to snap this 1/4 inch bolt with around 140 foot-pounds of torque. So that means to snap this 1 inch shank ball, we need around 4 times this much, right? Right, Joey?
Yeah, maybe. Let's see.
Now this is a 1 inch shank ball. It's coarse thread, it's SAE grade 5. So we're gonna put about 600 foot-pounds of torque using this nice little rig that Joey rigged up. It's a breaker bar with a 13 foot stainless steel pole. We're gonna hang sandbags on the end of it and see if it can snap this. So right now we have 182 foot-pounds of torque on this bolt right here. That's factoring in the weight of this 13 foot stainless steel pole. Now the first sandbag Joey's gonna put on is 35 pounds. And we're gonna keep adding bags from there to see what happens.
All right, let's do it.
Let's go. Do you need a ladder?
A ratcheting wrench won't work for this, so we gotta bust out a ladder to get this bar on the breaker bar.
So that's about 600 foot-pounds of torque on that bolt right there. So now we're gonna add another 25 pound sandbag, see if it bends it even more.
Six that we're adding.
Yeah.
Comes down. So this is 800 and this is about 900 foot-pounds.
This is stressful.
Do you guys really want to keep going?
You have the hook, Joey?
I've got the hook, yeah. All right, this is now getting like hard for me to move.
Damn, look at that pole bend. I don't want to be anywhere near this thing.
Is it on? Nope, hold on. That's good. This is like the worst game of Jenga.
This is the worst. I say we're done, dude. Fuck that. This is crazy, man. So we put over 1,000 foot-pounds of torque and it didn't shear. So what gives? Did our math fail us? Joey, is it your fault?
You know what? I can't put any more torque on this.
So why did a bolt 4 times the size of the little bitty experiment bolts not break with 4 times, or heck, even 7 times the force? Well, let me explain. Now, when you're buying bolts, they're measured in diameter. And diameter, that's a one-dimensional measurement. And to calculate tensile strength, we gotta use a two-dimensional measurement. A 1-inch diameter circle is 16 times the area of a 1/4-inch diameter circle. So we would have needed over 2,200 pound-feet of torque to break that bolt. But the math, it doesn't end there, because the area we need to use for the calculation isn't the flat end of the bolt. It's the area of the surface area of the threads. And that area is partially determined by the thickness of the bolt, but it's also determined by the thread pitch and depth. So with the larger bolt, you also have a larger nut, and the amount of threads contacting within that nut increases the surface area of threads touching and spreading out that force. So even a minor increase in bolt in diameter, thread length, or thread pitch can really change the amount of torque a bolt can take. Because of this, one of the big things that can really become a problem when torquing down bolts are contaminants. Now, if threads, if they're dirty, if they got grit in them, they got metal shavings, or even surface rust, that can change the amount of surface area making contact and lower the failure point of the bolt. Also, the amount of force needed to break up some of those contaminants could lead to a false reading on a torque wrench. I'm sure some of you guys may have heard the term dry torque, and that refers to the torque applied without lubricant, because lowering the friction that comes with lubrication can also throw off torque. So if you're a whiz boy or you're a whiz girl watching this show, you can see by just using a torque wrench, you can get an unreliable measurement. And that's because torque is the measurement of turning force applied to a bolt, not the amount of tension in the bolt itself. But unfortunately, there's no cheap or easy way to measure the actual tension in a bolt. So torque is the only number we've got to rely on. But because of this, there's another technique out there that makes torquing down fasteners to perfect spec super duper easy. It's called the torque and angle technique, and here is how it works. Instead of just the measurement in pound feet, you have a measurement and an angle. So if your torque spec is 30 pound feet and 90 degrees, you torque your bolt down to 30 pound feet, and then you'd give it a quarter turn. Why a quarter turn? Well, every 360 degrees of rotation of the bolt, the nut moves down the thread by a fixed amount. This is called the thread pitch. So when you start off with a lower torque value, snug torque, every degree of rotation after this will be used to stretch that bolt. Because no matter what, that quarter turn is going to move that bolt down the same amount of thread every single time. So this pretty much eliminates the effect that variations in friction have on the torquing process compared to when you're just using a torque value on its own. Now, if you want to see bolts get expertly torqued by Mr. Zach Job, go check out our series Money Pit. If you want to see some behind the scenes footage of all the stuff we can't include in this episode, because we're very serious in B2B, but sometimes we do a lot of goofy things that you don't get to see, go hit that join button down there and be a part of the Donut Underground. Follow me on Instagram at Jeremiah Burton. Follow us on Donut at Donut Media. Until next week. Bye for now.